Hi everybody. So in this video we're going to go a little bit deeper, or at least more quantitative, with regard to the action potential. So make sure you understand the basics of the action potential, what ions are moving where, either from my other video or any other resource about that. If we want to be a little more precise in our understanding of what's happening in the action potential and why, we need to get a little quantitative about it. So the first thing to remember is what's shown on this slide here, that you have these tremendous concentration differences that are created and maintained by the sodium-potassium pump. And what these are huge sources of potential energy, right? That when the permeability in the membrane becomes higher to one of these ions or both, it's going to be able to move toward its equilibrium. And it's not its chemical equilibrium, it's its electrochemical equilibrium, because there are both charge and concentration that affect the movement of these ions. So you already know, for example, that when sodium channels open, that is, sodium permeability in the membrane increases, sodium's going to rush into the cell. So what we want to ask now is, when will sodium stop moving? That is, what does sodium want the membrane potential to be? Or, of course, it doesn't want anything, it's an ion, but it's a way of thinking about it. What charge, what voltage will there be when sodium comes to equilibrium? Well, we can't figure this out just by thinking. We need to figure out how we can do it quantitatively, and luckily this has been done for us. We know the variables that we need to know to do this, and we know how to put them together. This is the Nernst equation. So what this tells us is what the voltage across the membrane will be when that ion comes to equilibrium. So for any ion, at mammalian room temperature, this number 61, you might see lower numbers in books and so on, because that's room temperature or squid body temperature or whatever. This is the mammal value. It doesn't really matter. It's the same form for all these different animals, all right? But this number will be slightly different. And this number takes into account temperature, the gas constant, and other things that aren't going to vary over the course of the action potential. So we just make this a number, all right? Z is actually also going to disappear because the two ions we're looking at are sodium and potassium, and Z is the charge on the ion. Since both of those are plus one, that disappears in the equation, since 61 divided by 1 is 61. All right, and then it's just the log of the concentration of the ion outside the cell versus inside. So the first thing you should do is look at this and be like, wow, this is going to be the opposite. This fraction is going to be the opposite for sodium and for potassium. Not exactly mathematically the opposite, but you have much more sodium outside the cell than inside, and vice versa for potassium. So the first thing you can do is look at this equation and say, well, I remember that the log of a number greater than 1 is going to be positive, and the log of a number less than 1, a fraction less than 1, is going to be negative. So sort of immediately you can look at this and say, sodium's equilibrium potential is going to be positive, and potassium's is going to be negative. All right? So we can do that, and we can calculate what these values are using any ion concentration values that you can find in a textbook or the internet. And when you do that, so for the example, for sodium, so I've gotten rid of the Z there, and I've changed ion to sodium there. And when we calculate that, we get a value again, depending on what values you use, of about plus 40 millivolts. Some books will have a value as high as plus 60 millivolts. That's fine. It just depends on the concentration values that you're plugging in from different cells that people have measured in different animals. For potassium, as we just figured out, it's a negative number, and that number is, in fact, a little bit more negative than the resting membrane potential. You may already know these values, but you don't know how we got them, all right? So these values tell us what the membrane potential will be driven toward when the ion has a chance to come to equilibrium. So during the action potential, you already know that you have a period of time when there's much greater permeability to sodium than at rest. The sodium channels are opening, sodium can move toward equilibrium, and that's what it does. See, there it is going toward its equilibrium, right? So this line will tell us, in fact, the sodium channels just stayed open. It isn't the case that the voltage would go up and up and up, but in fact, as soon as it gets to the equilibrium, it would flatten out, and that there are some drug conditions where that happens, where you make sodium channels unable to close, and indeed they stay open, and this is really bad for any animal or person who receives this toxin, but it's not going to, the voltage isn't going to get any higher. Once we reach equilibrium, we stop. And then this part of the action potential, the repolarization, what is this? Is a period of high permeability to potassium, and you can see potassium moving back, it's moving out of the cell, but moving the membrane of the cell back toward potassium's equilibrium potential. And of course, the reason why the resting membrane potential is so much closer to potassium's than to sodium's equilibrium potential is because there is some permeability to potassium at rest, right? And there's basically none to sodium. There's always a few ions that can get across the membrane, but there are no countable number of open ion channels. Okay, so if we want to say, well, what's the membrane potential then, right? Then what we just saw is that if you put the two Nernsts together, all right, if we can put this is basically this Na out over N, that's in the 61 log, that's the Nernst equation for sodium, and then here for potassium. But what I just said about the resting membrane potential is what it matters whether you're getting what you want, right? You can think of it like the equilibrium potential is what the ion wants, but permeability is whether it's getting what it wants. That is, are there open ion channels, right? So in this equation, the Goldman-Hodgkin-Katz equation, what you're doing is just taking those Nernsts, and in the full form of this equation, chloride is also included, but since it has a very minor contribution to the resting membrane potential, we often discard it, as I've done here. You take these two ions that contribute to the resting membrane potential or to the membrane potential during the action potential, and you multiply them by their permeabilities, because it doesn't really matter what sodium wants the membrane potential to be if there's no sodium permeability. It just isn't going to have any effect on that potential, because it can't move and change the potential toward its equilibrium. So let's go through the action potential and see how this works. Because at rest, right, the sodium channels are closed, and the voltage-gated potassium channels are closed, but the leak channels are open. So you actually have a lot more permeability to potassium than to sodium. So because of that, if we go back to this equation for a second, the pK, the permeability to potassium, is going to be significantly higher. It's not actually that high, because there aren't that many leak channels, but it's significantly higher than the permeability to sodium. So because of that, the membrane potential is much closer to potassium's equilibrium potential than to sodium's, because we're basically saying of these two values, the equilibrium potential for sodium and for potassium, the one that's pulling, the one with the permeability, the big multiplier in the GHK equation, is potassium, and it's, you know, sucking the value of the membrane potential down here. So that's fine, but you know that what happens at the beginning of the action potential is that these voltage-gated sodium channels open. So this situation, where there's more permeability to potassium than sodium, switches, right? And it becomes the case, see there's two arrows here now, there's much more permeability to sodium than to potassium. The leak channels are still present, but there's very few of them, and potassium doesn't have a strong driving force because it's near its equilibrium initially. So sodium, which has a strong driving force, a big concentration gradient, a big electrochemical gradient, it's very far from its equilibrium, right? It's going to come rushing into the cell through the numerous voltage-gated sodium channels that are present, and it's driving the membrane potential toward sodium's equilibrium potential. You can see we're sort of headed directly toward that. And we'll never go past it, because if we get there, we'll just level out. All right? Now, around the time that you get there, or in most cases, probably before you get to equilibrium, the sodium channels close, and the potassium channels, voltage-gated potassium channels, which had actually been slowly opening this whole time, become fully open. So now we're back in the case where there's more potassium permeability than sodium. In fact, much more, because it's not just the leak channels that are open, but also the voltage-gated potassium channels, which are very numerous. So potassium then rushes out of the cell. It now has a much stronger driving force than it would at rest, because the membrane potential has become very positive. So that positive charge is pushing, in a sense, potassium out of the cell and its huge concentration gradient. It has a high permeability, so you get a lot of movement of potassium out of the cell, and that causes that quick repolarization. Again, think it's going toward its equilibrium potential, all right? Its goal doesn't have a goal, it's an ion, but we can think of its goal as being driving the membrane potential toward its equilibrium value. Okay, and at the very end of the action potential, you return to the state where once the voltage-gated sodium and then eventually potassium channels close, we return to the resting values. Now, if you take the GHK equation then, you can use this to calculate at every moment what the membrane potential, right here, Vm, is going to be, because it depends on potassium's equilibrium potential, sodium's equilibrium potential, and then at any given time, which one of them is getting to move toward its equilibrium and therefore drive the membrane potential toward that. So in a quantitative way, at rest, for example, PNA is almost zero, not quite zero, but almost zero. And so this value, sodium's equilibrium potential essentially, doesn't contribute much, doesn't pull much, because the multiplier on it is so low, whereas potassium's is relatively high, and then those switch during the action potential. So to give you a specific example, here are some values I took from a textbook on the intracellular fluid and extracellular fluid concentrations of sodium and potassium. If you start with permeabilities for potassium of 0.3, so the permeability value is going to be between 0 and 1. 0.3 is actually a little bit high, but it makes our point well enough, and sodium's is quite low. If you plug those in, you'll find that you get a membrane potential that's quite similar to the known resting membrane potential. However, when sodium channels open, the potassium permeability stays the same. The voltage-gated potassium channels aren't open yet, but PNA has gone to 1. It's maxed out. You have tremendous permeability in the membrane. So now this value, the sodium essentially equilibrium potential, its concentration gradient, which multiplied by this or included with that is the equilibrium potential, is going to have a lot of pull on the resting membrane potential because the PNA value has gone up to 1. So if you recalculate that, you'll see that the membrane potential has changed quite a lot when you have a lot of permeability to sodium. So what you can do then is basically calculate GHK, the membrane potential, for any point in the action potential. And you can also think about it in a qualitative way, that the membrane that has greater permeability is going to be pulling the membrane potential toward that ion's equilibrium potential. Now, if you calculate it at every different moment like this, that absolutely works. You can do it as long as you have the permeability values. The concentrations, somewhat counterintuitively, don't change during this entire thing. It's like spitting in the ocean. Very small concentration differences. So we can do that, calculated at each different point, and then it's like taking a bunch of pictures and making them into one of those flip books, or even a movie is really just a series of pictures, right? But if you really want to look at something over time, you don't really want a lot of snapshots. you want the full picture of what change is happening over time. And so for that, we need calculus, right? I mean, that's what calculus is. So if you really want to look at how the membrane potential changes over time, you need to use a model that's based on calculus and specifically differential equations. So I'm not going to go into this in this video, but if you want to explore further, understanding how the action potential changes over time and how the membrane potential ever changes over time, you want to use this series of four differential equations, which Hodgkin and Huxley famously determined initially in the squid axon, but which can be applied to mammals and other situations. So enjoy, and don't forget to actually practice calculating the GHK equation, because it's very useful to see for yourself how the membrane potential changes. Okay, if you have questions, let me know.